Last week's gospel reading, the feeding of the 5,000, left Jesus' disciples on a spiritual high. And by the word disciples, I mean all of those who professed to follow Jesus, not just the 12 apostles. John tells us that immediately afterwards, the people exclaimed, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." Concerned that the people would try to take him by force to make him their king, Jesus immediately withdrew to the wilderness. In other words, he hid himself. The very next day, however, Jesus began a series of public teachings that seriously eroded his newfound popularity. He said somewhat cryptically, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." To the literal-minded disciples of Jesus, this made no sense. But then, Jesus made things even worse in their minds by making an even more outrageous claim. "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." That was simply too much for many of Jesus' disciples, and in all fairness, we can at least sympathize with those who wondered how eternal life could only be obtained by eating the flesh and drinking the blood of a still-living itinerant Jewish rabbi. Not surprisingly, John tells us that many of Jesus' disciples responded, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" So they turned back and no longer walked with Jesus. Nevertheless, some of Jesus' relatives saw an opportunity. The Feast of Booths, or the Feast of Tabernacles, was approaching, and they urged Jesus to join them in Judea, specifically Jerusalem, where they could essentially show him off to the disciples there, telling them that his hour had not yet come, and clearly not wanting to make the type of public splash that his relatives desired, Jesus declined and sent them on their way. Secretly, though, Jesus later entered into Jerusalem on his own and began to teach in the temple midway through the 8-day feast. Some of the Jews were converted by his preaching. Others accused him of having a demon because he claimed, correctly as it turns out, that some were plotting to kill him. Again, John mentions that no one laid a hand on Jesus because his hour had not yet come. In a somewhat humorous interlude, John recounts how the Pharisees sent officers to arrest Jesus. But on the last day of the feast, the officers came back empty-handed. The incredulous Pharisees asked the officers, "Why did you not bring him?" And the officers answered, "No one ever spoke like this man." By the end of the feast, some thought that Jesus was the so-called prophet. Some thought he was the Christ or Messiah. Others thought he was mad or that he had a demon. Yet others thought that he was a blasphemer who should be put to death. During his time in the temple, Jesus had made many bold claims. "The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. No one can come unto me unless it is granted him by the Father. I know the Father, for I come from him and he sent me. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. If you knew me, you would know my Father also. And finally, you are of this world. I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins." Exasperated by these audacious statements, Jesus' listeners asked him point blank, "Who are you?" This question sets the stage for today's gospel lesson, the climax of this part of Jesus' ministry. After some additional back and forth between Jesus and his audience, Jesus proclaims precisely who he is. "Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am." In saying this, Jesus had uttered the ultimate blasphemy, claiming not only to be sent by God, but to be God himself. We know this by looking back at Exodus chapter 3. Moses, having fled Egypt after killing an Egyptian taskmaster, encounters the famous burning bush. There, God commands Moses to return to Egypt and lead the Israelites out of bondage. Moses had several objections to this calling, and his first one was natural. If I come to the people of Israel and say to them, "The God of your fathers has sent me to you," and they ask me, "What is his name?" what shall I say to them? God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And God said, "Say this to the people of Israel, 'I am has sent me to you.' This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations." It is no wonder then that when Jesus called himself the great I am, those whose eyes were blinded and who lacked understanding sought to stone him immediately. No arrest was needed, no time-consuming trial was required for such an outrageous claim. Yet John tells us, Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Not because he was afraid. After all, Jesus had just moments earlier predicted his own crucifixion. Rather, Jesus had hid himself that day because, as we are repeatedly told, his hour had not yet come. Jesus would return later to the temple with great fanfare, and that occasion is the triumphal entry which we will commemorate next Sunday. Meanwhile, today, the beginning of Passion Tide, we commemorate the hidden Jesus, symbolized by the veiling of all crosses and crucifixes in purple. This veiling reminds us that we too are often blind to Jesus because of our sins. We are reminded to intensify our own examination of conscience, asking the Holy Spirit to remove the veil from our spiritual eyes, so that we may see Jesus more clearly, and that we may perceive and confess those hidden sins which beset us, sins we do not remember or have committed in ignorance, sins also which we simply have not acknowledged and confessed. In this Passion Tide, let us daily pray David's heartfelt plea in Psalm 19, C.S. Lewis's favorite psalm, by the way. "O cleanse thou me from my secret or hidden faults. Keep thy servant also from presumptuous sins, lest they get the dominion over me. So shall I be undefiled and innocent from the great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer."